Indians. Naga. Chitahuri, genies, different cultures give them different names, but we in Islam call them the jinn. The most infamous of the jinn was Iblis. Iblis is also known as Satan. In the beginning, he was the most pious of the jinn, who have existed long before man. But when man was created in the form of Adam, God ordered all his creation to bow down before Adam in respect. It was then that Satan's pride took over and he disobeyed God. His pride was the weapon of his own decline, as he was cast out of heaven. However, before being cursed as such, he challenged God that he would lead astray all of mankind, the creation that was preferred above him.
I've nurtured every sensation man has been inspired to have. I cared about what he wanted, and I never judged him. Why? Because I never rejected him, in spite of all his imperfections. I'm a fan of man!
Thus began his mission to cause corruption within the individual humans, and ultimately between the person and his Lord. He went about this corruption through his jinn followers, commanding them to inflict their influence upon every one of us. The jinn reside in a world similar to ours. There are those of them who are pious believers, and those who are the disbelievers. Within them there are different religions, races, and sexes. They sometimes enter our world through different forms. The jinn are known to physically manifest into our world as black dogs, black cats, black birds, and snakes. There are even instances where they were able to manifest into human form. However, their most immediate effect in our world is in the influencing of mankind through whispering into our subconscious, placing certain ideas and thoughts onto our heads. By this method, they are able to tempt mankind into committing sins, thus fulfilling the wishes of their master Satan. These sins, such as losing one's temper, the consumption of intoxicants, and the commitment of adultery, eventually make it easier for these jinn to possess the sinner. Such possession allows the jinn to have greater influence on the human, making the human a successful result of Satan's challenge to God. Possession is a spiritual battle between the human and the jinn, and is only successful for the jinn if the human spirit has been continuously weakened through external exposure to a sinful lifestyle. There are ultimately two forms of possession, voluntary and involuntary possession. Involuntary possession occurs when a human soul has become tainted due to disbelief, continuous sinning, or staying in a state of impurity for prolonged periods of time. Voluntary possession, however, is another story. This type of possession occurs when the jinn is commissioned through magic to possess the individual. The individual takes part in certain satanic and black magic rituals to which the jinn is voluntarily invited to possess the human. These acts are conducted by humans who have been exposed to jinn communication in the past. This communication eventually leads to the agreement between man and jinn for voluntary possession. The man agrees to this because he knows that giving the jinn the pleasure of possession would in return allow the jinn to perform certain services for the man. These services are what eventually led most men to the top level of society in terms of wealth, fame, and political influence. And ultimately, these men will eventually be led astray, falling right into the hands of Satan.
How in the world did you ever get involved in praying to demon spirits?
Well, when I came out of the Navy after World War II, I was looking for to take up a trade in Montreal, Canada. And at that time, I ran across a fellow that had been on a particular ship with me. And he said, "Hey, Mono, you're alive. How nice to meet you." He says, "Let's have dinner tonight." I said to my boss, "Can I have the evening off?" So I got the evening off and I went out to have dinner. He told me, "Hey, I got something fantastic to tell you." He said, "I am affiliated with people that speak with the spirits of the dead. How would you like to talk to the spirit of your dead mother?" And I was shocked. I was shocked. He said, "You wouldn't be afraid of talking to the spirit of your dead mother, would you?" Well, I said, "I'll tell you what, I would have to give that some thought. That's something I never thought about before in my life."
Most of us probably haven't. A little afraid of something like that.
Well, he says, you know, it's written all over your face. You're afraid of going to a seance. But he says, "I know you. You're going to come." And then he started telling me how brave I was when I was aboard ship, you know, different things. He says, "You're not the same man, you're changed. You're chicken." That's all I needed to hear. I said, "When do we go to a seance?" So one Saturday evening, we were in the place. It was her first time, very beautiful place. The medium was a lady. She had a gorgeous new home in Montreal. And there were about 20 invited guests there, which I was one of them. And she communicated with the spirits for different people there. And you're telling them what the spirit said. One man that said, "I would like to talk to my friend that died 6 months ago. But I don't want him to appear. Just want to talk to him. Because he says, I don't trust you talking to my friend for me." So the medium says, "Let me inquire of the spirit." "Yeah, the spirit will talk with you." And that big masculine voice was heard in the place. It says, "Hi, Frank. It's nice of you to ask for me to talk with you." And they had a little chat. And after it was over, Frank says, "This is the greatest thing honored, to be able to talk with the spirits of the dead."